Boy, is that a long.
Yeah. There was a report.
I don't, Mike, I don't think I can even give a short answer. But my short answer was a yes. Go have lunch and I'll tell you what I think about it and what my evidence is, but I'm not going to try and do it tonight.
Well, the affordable housing report was.
Yes.
Pretty good.
I don't want to have to write a report.
A very short answer, Judy, is that it's very hard to, we had a chapter in that report about snapshots versus moving pictures. You take a snapshot of Salisbury and say, what's the need? We don't have any people living under the bridge over here by the library. We don't have anybody living in packing crates. What's this need for housing? So a snapshot doesn't tell anything because the answer is they're not here. We see all the evidence of declining school population, the graduates of Lusitanic from Salisbury, not living in Salisbury, but living in the neighboring towns, the 52-year-old average age in the ambulance squad, the difficulty of getting firefighters, and just anecdotal evidence every day about people who say, I just can't live here. There's no bottom to the housing ladder. There's no bottom rungs to the housing ladder. And that's mostly rentals. We saw this POCD article about Falls Village last week in the Journal, and I was intrigued to see that the survey that they did came up with 968 approximately single-family owner-occupied houses and 9 rental units. I mean, that's not a housing market. You can't get started on that housing in that housing market. You cannot have a diverse community by age and occupation with 9 rental units.
The other thing I would say, just again, as a housing commission coordinator, the people who call me who need housing, who live and work in town, really need rental housing, the ones that are calling me right now. And what they really need is like a 1 or 2 bedroom apartment for $600. Something that's, you know, technically affordable unit, like a 1 or 2 bedroom at Sarum Village that isn't subsidized is still $800. And, you know, some of the units at Sarum Village are subsidized, but some of them are not. And there are a lot of people who live and work in Salisbury who are not able to pay $800 a month. That's one need that I'm hearing.
That issue doesn't get answered by IHC. That gets answered by altering our own zoning regulations from the foolhardiness of 3 units in a building, which, you know, is just in economic sense for a landlord. You're not going to be affordable if you only 3 units. You've got to make your money. And, you know, you also have to consider on units, too. I know a lot of times we throw it around, and as a renter, you have to consider what utilities may or may not be included. While one may balk at the rent I pay, he pays the heating bill. And guess what? That's a huge chunk right there. And so, you know, if you're looking at a unit, if I have to pay my separate heating bill, especially in this day and time, the affordability curve goes out the door. And if we allow, you know, more units in a building, we have a few old buildings that are grandfathered, and buildings that probably have more, that's where the change comes. And that's simply in our own regulations, right? I guess I'm just like, I'm kind of like, Michael's not here, I'm sure he'd be saying the same thing. It's up to us to decide what happens in this town. My big fear of IHC is that OPM is dictating certain things to us. They're reviewing everything we do. And they can do that to it if they so wish. And so we could sit here for 6 months creating regulations for an IHC, send them out to Hartford and have them say, no. I'd rather create our own stuff and look at our own solutions that could be worthwhile. And that apartment was one I think we should be looking at in the near future.
Well,
now I'm making a statement.
Yeah, you can walk to your own. Yeah.
I think as far as our agenda goes, we're having our general discussion.
I think we are. We're having our general discussion. And, as far as communication is concerned, I mean, you're collaborative. Jessica, you want to say about that? Yes. Be a collaborative with us.
Sure, yeah. What you and I had talked briefly about before? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, what we have done with some of the other planning and zoning commissions, which has been great for us, is actually had one person on the commission sort of be a liaison with the collaborative, which just means, for example, Jessica Fowler on the Sharon Planning and Zoning Commission, 2 days before a meeting, she'll email at me and say, Jocelyn, what's the collaborative up to? Especially in regards to what's going on in Sharon with signage or economic development or anything. And I'll shoot her off an email saying, this is what's going on. Of course, all of this is more or less in the collaborative's newsletters, but I do try to keep them short and applicable to everybody that gets them. Hopefully you all are on the list if you want to be. But it would be great to have that in Salisbury as well. Somebody who could just write me an email and say, Jocelyn, what's going on? And I'd be also happy to do a quick update on what's going on with the Housing Commission, if that would be useful. Just a brief, we're still working on signage. The kinds of projects that Collaborative is working on now are in Salisbury, for example, are mainly focused on economic development, supporting the local businesses, which has been, for example, signage, visitor information, and working with the Economic Development Committee in town on various ways to support local businesses. This secret corner project we've been working on, again, to get more visitors to the northwest corner, because we all know that our businesses won't stay open if they have to rely on only those of us who live here full-time to go to them.
And that's on your website?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Specifically for Salisbury, what specific things have happened here from some of these grounds? I'm looking at your newsletter right now, and a lot of money that's spread across. Can you tell us what's happening here with that money?
Yep, I have a spreadsheet actually just for Salisbury and what's going on here. As an example, one of the things we worked on recently with the Board of Selectmen, we helped write applications for the Main Street Investment Fund. I think that application was you could apply for up to $500,000, and I think almost that much was applied for to do infrastructure improvements in the village centers. So we helped write that grant application as part of that, and I think I CC'd Michael on this, and we had to do a town commercial center plan as part of that application. And basically what we ended up doing, because you had such a great town plan, I think it had been adopted, or it was almost going to be adopted at that point. So we could just refer to those sections of the town plan, and then it just, every grant application you do has slightly different requirements. So we had to just add a couple maps to show the kinds of infrastructure improvements in the village centers that were being applied for. That was a recent project that we did.
When will you hear about that? If you've been successful, you need that grant money.
We don't know. The state's taking their time these days. I don't know if you guys have heard anything, but we certainly haven't. We're in communication a lot with OPM and DECD, trying to find out when we might know about various things. Even the STEEP, we did a STEEP grant, through the Housing Commission, I did a STEEP grant application for the Salisbury Housing Trust to potentially purchase a property. We were supposed to find out about that, in November. Now it's February, and they still haven't finished making their award announcements. So I know they're still reviewing them, and I have no sense of when they might start making award announcements.
The STEEP grant from 2012, the 80,000 amongst the towns.
Yeah.
I believe you put a kiosk in Cornwall, if I'm correct? Or a visitor, what I'm calling it a kiosk, and that's probably not the right thing. You've done some stuff with that in each of the towns.
Yep, the way that breaks down, that was $80,000 fee grant for visitor information and wayfinding signage in the eight towns. So each town basically has $9,000 it can spend on those types of signage. So we've been working with the Board of Selectmen and the business groups in each town to figure out what would be the best, you know, what signs are needed in those towns, where they're needed. And the ones that have been installed so far have been installed in Cornwall.
Okay, that's what I was thinking.
And
any for Salisbury, Lakeville?
No, not yet. One of the frustrating things is working with the Department of Transportation on permitting them because, well, you know, this, we did design the signs that are on Library and Academy Street through a previous Connecticut Main Street grant that we had gotten. We designed those signs and they were just lucky that they were able to be put on town land. But in the other towns, there isn't town land there, and in most of our village centers, the land where you could see a sign as a motorist driving by through the village center is owned and managed by the Department of Transportation. Their requirements are difficult, to say the least, and constantly evolving. I mean, at first, it took us basically a year just to get them to let us write something like shops and restaurants on a sign that went within the DOT right-of-way. Mm-hmm. We finally got them to consider, and they wrote pilot project, to their credit, they wrote pilot project guidelines just to allow us signs within the right-of-way that say things like shops and restaurants. And now it's just getting through every single sign, the location of it. You've got to have DOT come out, look at it from all points of view, think about how, and every time what they decide changes and every location. So in terms of Salisbury Lakeville, I have talked with the Salisbury Economic Development Committee isn't meeting much anymore, although I have several meetings with them, facilitated some of them when they were. We have talked about some signage that might could go here. And I did meet with a group of Lakeville business owners to talk about what signage might be helpful in Lakeville. That proposal went to the Board of Selectmen and they talked about it. And we've got to think about it some more based on further discussions with DOT and what locate, you know, every town we do, every time we go on a site visit with DOT, I learn more about what they may or may not approve, and then they have to move forward with redesigning, re-looking at locations.
Justin, I have two questions. The economic development group you just referred to now, is that sort of the merchants group? I mean, that Judy and I visited once with you, is that the group of people you're talking about?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember the meeting. That when
Judy presented her concept plan for the POCD.
At Peter Beck's.
Yes, and there was a meeting previously at...
Yep, that's the group.
The county, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so then, okay. Mm-hmm. And then my other question follows on from what Mike said when he was talking about the grant money. So there's been, you know, the $80,000 for the different towns for signage and wayfinding. Mm-hmm. The steep grant you worked on with the Housing Commission, $500,000 for the Main Street. What other grant monies has the Collaborative worked on in the last year? Have there been any others?
We ended up getting $32,000 to work on this Discover the Northwest Corner of Connecticut campaign branding. There's the website that now has a whole page for the town of Salisbury. It's the only one that actually has two pages because Salisbury and Lakeville has its own page. Again, that the purpose of that website is to bring people, visitors, to the northwest corner to support our local businesses. So that was a project we've been really working on, and now we're...
Who did that? The graphics and branding for that?
A company called Studio 2.
And where are they?
They're in Lenox.
Okay, thank you.
Have you seen it? I have got some. I have, if you're interested, I have with me the, so we've done a website, a brochure, and now with the new grant that we got, we're working on, meeting again with all the local business groups and, trying to get everyone to link their websites to this website and put a secret corner sticker on the window and pass out these brochures. So the brochures talk about all 8 towns and what there is to do in them. And we think a graphically compelling way. Again, the idea is stay in one town, visit them all, go to all the village centers. We think that our 8 towns present a critical mass of businesses and interesting things to see and do that could draw people here.
What kind of visitor stats are you seeing at the new website?
Right now, we haven't been able to do things yet. I'm just learning about this business, but we haven't been able to do much marketing of the website aside from internal marketing, telling other businesses about it and getting it in the newspaper. We were on NBC Morning Show one time, and we got a big blip from that. But basically, without spending any money on Google AdWords or doing any of that stuff, we get, just from people basically happening on it, we get about 100 new visitors every week, which I think is pretty good, seeing as how we haven't really spent any money on getting it out there too much. And then the other thing we're doing is working with the local groups on possibly finding a site in each town for a visitor information board that would have a map on it and a directory, a kind of You Are Here map, and a directory of the local businesses. So, I've been, and you probably all have too, walking in town and somebody says, where can I get a sandwich? Or, and I'm happy to answer the question, but I could also say, here's a board here, that tells you the 4 different places to get a sandwich, and then I won't accidentally forget somebody. So we're doing that in each town, and again, in each town, they have the map of the town, the directory of businesses in just that town, but it would also have this kind of secret corner, you're in Cornwall, you can just scoot over to Salisbury and visit those shops, and then we'll all kind of be marketing each other. So that's the other kind of major thing we've been working on.
How do you
have a very quick comment, and that is, as you're spreading out among your friends and family, Curtis does get, and has gotten recently, people coming into his office saying, I saw this brochure, and we don't want tour buses in Salisbury, and so on, to which the logical answer, I think, is there's a long distance from our businesses staying in business and tour buses. there's a happy medium. I've never seen a tour bus in Salisbury. Uh-huh. There are places like Stockbridge that intended to get tour buses, and they got them, and that's great. That's only what they want. But there is some backlash. Curtis gets people coming in all the time saying, what's this? Why are you trying to get more tourists into Salisbury? Well, trying to get more tourists into Salisbury to keep the retail establishments that you use open. But just so you know, there's another side to that question in our wonderfully diverse town.
The other kind of bigger project we worked on in Salisbury is actually coordinating the 8 towns to apply and create this regional housing rehabilitation loan program. Luckily, the town of Salisbury agreed to be the lead town on that, which is terrific. Because it does take some work to get through the application process and administer the program as the lead town. But, and the other reason we did it as eight towns is because we believe, and I think this is still true, that it's a more competitive application to the state if you're doing things regionally, because they like to see that. And we're about to apply again, hopefully, for more money for this program, and we're eligible for a lot more money as a eight-town collaborative than we would be if the town of Salisbury just applied on its own. But the great thing about this program, if you don't know about it, is that it allows people who basically can't afford to fix their roof or fix their septic issue, or, you know, they don't have heat. There's more people in our towns like that than we know, than we think, than we hope there would be. If they can't afford to do it, this is basically a loan that they can get at 0% interest, and it wouldn't have to be repaid until basically they transfer title to their house.
And how long does it take to get the approval for those funds? When it's cold and the heat goes off.
It is not a perfect, it's not a fast program that doesn't work quickly. It takes 9 months to a year from the time you apply till the time you get any money. So we were successful in this application. The first time we got $300,000 for this program, but as you might imagine, $300,000 in eight towns doesn't really serve very many people. However, and so we're starting to serve those folks now, have visits, house visits to see what they need and that sort of thing. But we actually need to be getting more applications. We need to establish a waiting list in order to apply for more money. So if you know of anybody who is interested or could be, who wants to.
No one really wants to be on the waiting list.
On the waiting list.
So it's a great place to be.
I know, but the thing is, if we don't,
If
we don't have the waiting list, we can't tell the state we have the need for more money.
Mm-hmm.
But we could apply for up to $600,000 more, which could serve many more residents of these eight towns. If we can get people to fill out, it's a two-page application.
Are these loans or grants?
These are loans.
0%.
But they're 0% interest, and they don't have to be repaid until the transfer title. So for an elderly person, for example, who isn't planning to transfer title to their house until they leave it to their children, when they leave it to their children will have to pay off the loan to fix their roof or whatever. Mm. But until then, they don't have to make payments on it. They don't have to worry about it.
Very good.
Is there income guidelines for this?
I only brought a couple of these, but there's more down in the brochure holder thing. But it's the same. It's 80% of the area median income. So.
It's on your collaborative website too. It explains mm-hmm. all that.
Yeah. For a family of four, it's $64,000. If you make $64,000 or less in your family of four, you would qualify. If your family of one, $45,000 or less, you would qualify. So that's another. Mainly what the collaborative has been focused on is really more town plan implementation, working on actually implementing strategies that are in a lot of our towns, town plans related to either housing or economic development. That's what we've been working on. Back to the initial point, if there is anybody who would be willing to do that, I'd be happy to give a Salisbury specific update before, once a month before a meeting.
I'm
happy to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
I was hoping
you'd
say that,
Kevin.
Okay.
It's an event. It's a
great, yeah.
Because there are various opportunities.
The
initial
liaison. Right. That is.
there are various grant opportunities that come up, and it is good to be able to, like the Main Street Investment Fund, I think I called you guys, but that was one of those things where we got word about the funding, and we had, you know, 4 weeks to pull it together, and you have to have shovel-ready projects. So, but, you know, it is just good to have that, that communication line open.
Well, it's great that you can come here and talk to us, and hope we'll make it more of a regular thing.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
May I keep that copy of the brochure?
Yeah.
She has them for sale on the website, so you can hand them out to your friends.
For sale?
I got mine at Peter's house.
Good, and thanks for coming, Jim.
You're welcome.
Josh. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second, is there a second?
Second is special.
By John? All in favor?